good morning, Dick. It's 6 a.m. Come on, wake up. You haven't taken a shave since 5.
I am the president. I still am the president. Every night before I fall asleep, I think that when I wake up, maybe it's all just a dream, and I'm really not the president after all.
Maybe the country can dream that, but you really are still the president, Dick, believe it or not. I'll prove it to you. I'll turn on the radio. You'll hear your name. You'll see.
Don't do that, Pat, please. The news is all bad. All the networks are always saying bad things about me. Just can't take it anymore. I wished hard enough, Pat, and I became the president. Maybe if I wished hard enough again, I could maybe have my own radio station. Just think of it, Pat. My own station. My own station. My own station.
My own 72 WNIX 110% American. Are you?
Good morning. This is your announcer, Henry Fonda, with WNIX on the air. And now here he is, the man who is still your president, believe it or not.
Hail to the chief, Dick Nixon.
Good morning, my fellow Americans, and welcome to the Dick Nixon Show, starring me, the wit from Whittier. Hello, I'm Richard Milhouse. That rhymes with White House. And that's where I'm coming to you, from the White House pool, where I've drained the water and I'm sitting here in the deep end. First, let's see what the headlines are. Nixon booed again. Well, let me say this about that. Boo, boo. I can boo, boo as well as anyone. I think it's time for the silent majority of this country to stand up and be counted. Sit down, Pat. Thank you, Tricia. And might I add, and of course I will add, because after all, I am the president, might I add how neat you look in your three-piece swimsuit. Oh, weather, 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 weather. It's me again with the weather. The climate in the country is not that good. I'll admit that. Something seems to be casting a shadow over the country. Oh, well, weather, 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 over. And now the portion of the show, my fellow Americans, where people call me on the phone to ask anything that's on their mind. Anybody at all. Anybody with a phone. Oh, it's lighting up like a bulb on a Christmas tree. I'm so excited. Hello, this is your president. Will you identify yourself?
Hello? How are you, Mr. President? This is the actor, George C. Scott.
Well, this is an unexpected pleasure. Mr. Scott, if you only knew, if you could only imagine the influence that your performance as Patton has had on me and my entire family. Why, for weeks at a time, David Eisenhower in his one-star general's helmet and I in my five-star general's helmet walked around the White House. And right behind us were Tricia, Pat, and Julie in their army combat boots.
Well, that is very complimentary of you, Mr. President, and I appreciate it. But I have a confession to make. I'm really an actor playing a part.
Do you mean to tell me, Mr. Scott, that all those battles, all those beautiful battles that Pat and I sat through holding hands were merely part of a movie made in Hollywood? That is disappointing.
Mr. President, I just want to ask you one other thing, you know, while I had you on the phone. Did you by any chance see any of my other movies, like, did you see Dr. Strangelove?
No, I haven't seen Dr. Strangelove.
Well, Mr. President, do yourself and everybody else a favor. Don't bother to see it.
Well, that was fun, wasn't it, my fellow Americans? Trace that call. And now I'll take another telephone call. Better yet, let's play our telephone game. That's where I surprise some American out there. And believe me, your president has plenty of surprises for you. I surprise them by calling them up and saying hello. What a thrill it's going to be for some American to speak to me, the president. I'll just dial any number in the phone book.
Hello?
Hello, Mrs. Herman Ginsburg?
Yes, this is she.
Well, you're on the radio, Mrs. Ginsburg.
What? Oh, I don't believe it. I'm so excited. Herm, I'm on the radio.
And Mrs. Ginsburg, do you know whom you're speaking to?
Oh, no, I can't stand it. I'm dying.
This is President Richard Nixon.
This is Al Cap. This morning, boys and girls, I'm gonna read you the latest installment of my new cartoon character, Lil Hard Hat. We last left Lil Hard Hat. He and his pals on the construction site were just breaking for lunch, and we see in the picture Lil Hard Hat dropping a steel beam from the 36th floor down on a procession of war protesters. Kaplunk, bazoom, kerpow, say the war protesters in their typically poor grammar. And then Joe yells, "Good shot, Lil Hard Hat. No wonder the president has called you to Washington to congratulate you on preserving the dignity of the American way." Or, "Hey, girlie, look up here. Show us your bazungi." And we next see Lil Hard Hat in the office of the president. "Now let me make one thing perfectly clear," the president says. "Lil Hard Hat, anyone who respects the flag the way you do deserves a special honor, and I'm going to honor you. This Tuesday night, you are invited to join Pat and me for bowling." So, tune in tomorrow at the same time, boys and girls, and of course, President-elect David Eisenhower, to hear the rest of this fantastic story.
Mr. Camp, excuse me. Will you come with us, please? They're waiting for you. Get the jacket.
Of course not.
That's it.
What are you talking about? Well, put down that net. No. I'm not through yet. I've got to go on. I've got to save America.
You better come with me. Please.
Don't drag him. Please. I used to be a liberal. Believe me, I was. No, that tickles.
WNIX, the White House.
Down on the farm, WNIX, down on the farm.
Now it's time again for the Morning Farm Report.
Good morning, my fellow Americans. This is your ex-president, soon to be your legend. But now your former in residence, here along the banks of the Perdnance. Well, hogs are down, beef is down, grain is down, and let me tell you, I'm down. But Ladybird is up.
Hi, and how are you?
Bird, what are you doing rattling around so early in the morning?
Beautifying, Lyndon. It's my life's work, and it occupies my every waking hour. I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows. Flowers, trees, and bushes are beautiful things. Did you ever see an ugly bush?
Bird, do me a favor, will you? Flap your wings and fly away and write another me. Now back to the farm report. Things on the farm today are the same as they are every day. Lonely. No one ever comes by no more. Sure, Cronkite came poking around for a while, asking all kinds of questions. And Spiro dropped in. But it's not the same anymore. You think sitting around here listening to ladybirds singing happy trails to you all the livelong day is my idea of having a good time? You're crazy. Well, they took my phones away. They're cutting me off from civilization, my fellow Americans. If there's anyone out there listening, do something, please. Well, farmers, thanks to government subsidies, this coming year's gonna be a great one for not growing corn, barley, alfalfa, or any other stuff that comes out of the ground.
Oh, Lyndon, we don't do nothing anymore. We just sit around here playing checkers.
Cool it, bird. Tune in tomorrow at the same time for the morning farm report. I'll be here. I'm always here. Just tell you the truth, I ain't got nowhere to go no more. Until then, this is LBJ saying...
Good evening, friends. Dr. Billy Graham here. Let me step into your living rooms tonight and your parlors and talk to you for a moment about your soul and its salvation. Yes, I said unto you, the soul and its salvation. Now you may ask yourself, and rightly so, what is Dr. Billy Graham doing in my parlor talking to me about my soul and salvation? Hearken unto me, brothers and sisters, because I come unto you to talk not of your soul and salvation, but that of your automobile. Yes, your automobile. I said unto you, your automobile. I stand before you now and tell you to use LTP oil treatment. Just rend the top of the cap of LTP and add it right to the crankcase of your machine. Lo, let your crankcase runneth over. Let LTP be the salvation of your auto's problems. It goes right to the soul of your machine. Trust me. Trust Billy. Get LTP. Would I steer you wrong? And tell them he sent you.
LTP for the Saver's Edge.
And now it's time once again for... Face the Country. And your host for Face the Country, Davy Susskind.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is David Susskind. Tonight, we have with us on our panel a cross-section of political thought in America as we remembered it this morning. First, but not least, a man who is known to millions of Americans as Mr. Middle of the Road, Richard Milhouse Nixon.
Good evening. It certainly is nice to be here tonight.
Next, a man who may be described and has been described as slightly right of center, Mr. Bill Buckley. Bill, welcome to our show.
Good evening. It certainly is very nice to be here tonight.
And now, representing the cross-section of our rebellious college-age youths, and there are so many of those around today, but I really think that we have a good representative. Here he is, Davy Eisenhower.
Hiya. Peace.
Thank you so much. You all know each other, and you also know the format of our show. You will be asked questions by members of the audience, to which you will have to give an answer. Is that clear?
You mean if I am asked a question, I will answer in a manner that is expected of me,
And I always will do what is expected of me. Not only what is expected of me, but what is expected of all Americans.
You generally have the right impression.
In other words, Mr. Suskin, to paraphrase the president, to assure that we are all engaging in a social intercourse, upon entering an arena of agreement, under an harmonious, copacetic understanding, we shall endeavor to present recourse to all queries that may indeed be directed for our attention.
Well, Bill Buckley, what can I say? I wouldn't have, as you know, how shall I put it? You know, well, yeah.
Ah, that's easy for you to say.
I see a hand.
My question is for the kingfish, the dude there in the blue suit.
The who?
The chief, yeah, the cat there in the blue suit.
Well, I can answer that very simply.
Hey, chief, let me ask the question first, baby.
I'm terribly sorry. Excuse me.
Yeah, well, I won't know. See, man, that Spiro Agnew dude, he rapping around with all that funky jive. What I want to know is he blowing his own mind, or did you just tell him where his head is at and say, go, baby, rock on, I believe.
If I can, I would like to have an interpreter for that man's question.
Yes, Dad. I believe he wishes to be informed as to whether or not Uncle Spiro speaks for himself or for you.
Neither one. Spiro is speaking for Martha Mitchell. Everyone knows that my philosophy, the philosophy of Richard Nixon, is clearly expressed daily in newspapers throughout the country.
You mean, of course, conservative editorials?
No, in the Nancy and Sluggo strip. Politically, I'm right of Nancy, but left of Sluggo.
Golly, isn't anyone going to ask me a question? I think I know an answer.
Is there a question for Master Eisenhower?
Yes. How does it feel to be married to Julie and be living in the shadow of a father-in-law who's president of the nation?
Well, I don't mind it. After all, we must remember come 5 o'clock, President Nixon has a shadow of his own to live under. I mean...
What was that?
Oh, boy.
What was that he just said? We interrupt this program to bring you a special message from the man who is just a heartbeat away from being the head of our station. My fellow Americans, Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, and she sells seashells by the seashore. Well, I guess you know who this is. Beware. There are discordant sounds in this land of ours. These sounds are the clear, cold, clarion cries of a clique of clattering congressmen, the fulminations of those frogmen of futility, fraught with a fever of fear and frustration. Don't heed the muddled, meaningless mutterings of this maladjusted minority. You know as well as I that they're nothing more than peculiar, petulant, pernicious prophets living in Pittsburgh. Thank you. What is that man talking about?
Respect the majesty of the presidency. 72 WNIX.
And now a look at today's weather with Mr. Truman Capote.
When I was very small, there were very few people who would even consider me. Good evening, everyone. This is Truman Capote, or better known to my friends in prison as number 3792089. Can you believe it? Me, Truman Capote, famed novelist, behind bars with hardened criminals? Let me tell you, it was terrific. And now it's time for the weather. The high today will be in the 60s. There will also be a high among 50% of our population, but that's another story altogether. I don't know what time the sun rose this morning, as I never remove my dark glasses even while I'm asleep. And now for the big news in weather. I plan to investigate, as a matter of fact, I've been working on it for quite some time. I want to investigate the cause of the current unseasonably warm weather that we've been having. And my hunch is that someone has killed Jack Frost. Now, the police are now holding Old Man Winter as prime suspect. Hello, who is it?
I'm going to let you guess.
Well, am I speaking to a king?
I like to think of myself as someone who has been crowned.
What do you want, Dick?
Truman, I'm going to be very honest with you, because as you know, I am an honest man. I'm very upset with you.
What's wrong? Did I lisp during the weather report?
It's much worse than that. I just found out something from the CIA.
Well, gracious heavens, what did you find out, Dickie?
That I wasn't invited to your latest party.
Now, just calm down and listen to me. My barbecue bash Saturday night is, first of all, very small. Please understand that. I'm only having my very closest friends, 3,000 of them. And to tell you the truth, Dickie, I'm only having VIPs.
Well, what am I? A piece of chopped liver?
Well, Dick, let's not play these silly games. Honestly, I'm just not in the mood for it.
Truman, I'm not asking for myself. I would never ask anything for myself. I'm not that kind of person. I'm asking for Pat. Pat loves a good party.
Yes, Pat. I always confuse her with Baby Jane Holzer.
She'll even come in a costume.
You mean like the one she wore to the inaugural?
Would you consider David and Julie?
No, I already have enough in help.
How about Trisha?
No, much too flashy.
I could play the piano.
No.
I'll bring my Mantovani albums.
No. 1,000 times no.
I'll bring Judy Agnew.
Well, in that case, be there at 7:30 and don't forget to shave.
We interrupt this program for this special bulletin from General Hospital. William F. Buckley, Jr. was released today following surgery as a result of an accident which occurred at a speaking engagement when his tongue lashed out and became entangled in the grill of the microphone. Upon leaving the hospital, Mr. Buckley had this to say.
The physicians did a masterful job, and I'm ready for my next speaking engagement in Cincinnati. Thank you.
What did he say?
It's time once again for another chapter of the compelling, never-ending saga of As the Country Burns. The ongoing story of the man and the women and the son-in-law who believed in him. The tale of a plain man who found a lukewarm place in the hearts of approximately 44% of America's voting public. As we join him now, Dick is saying...
Pat, would you please pass me the meatloaf and the ketchup?
Surely, dear.
And the mashed potatoes. And make no mistake about it, I also would like to have the white bread.
Here you go.
And the American cheese. And the mayonnaise. That's always good.
It's good to see you eating well again. You've been so nervous lately. You've even lost your fabulous sense of humor.
Pat, while you're up, would you make a fire in the fireplace and turn on the air conditioner?
But, Dick, it's so costly.
Well, what are you worried about? We don't have to pay for it.
Oh, Dick, you're so nervous.
You're right, Pat. I'm in a bummer lately. I don't know what it is. It's just that they put me down on television last night.
Laughing again?
No, the news programs.
What did they say this time?
The same old thing. They put down the war, the racial strife, the violence in the cities.
What did they say about me?
Nothing as usual.
Darn it. What do they want from me? I'm only a cashier from California. Dick, I have an idea.
Uh-oh.
We have our own radio station. Why not a television station? The Johnsons had a television station.
Well, as you know, Pat, I've never looked very good on television.
I do.
No, you don't. If you did, you'd have done the White House tour.
You like Tricia better than me.
Now, don't start with me again. I have enough trouble with David Brinkley.
Will David and Julie get over feeling badly that they didn't attend their own graduation ceremonies? Will Dick resolve his latest crisis without the help of Dr. Henry Kissinger, who is out frugging with Jill St. John? Will B.B. Rebozo tune in tomorrow when Dick says...
Pat, I'm home.
Whoopee, why don't you play the piano?
As the country burns.
WNIX Sports.
Good evening, loud voice fans. This is Howard Cosell talking to the man who just set the world endurance record for being governor of New York State. I'm talking about Rocky Rockefeller. Put it there. Easy, does it? Rocky, may I take the liberty of calling you Nelson A. Rockefeller?
Right on, fella, right on.
And you just set a world record as governor. Could you tell my fans all about that?
Yes, well, I became governor of New York for the 12th year. The previous record was 11 and 10 for a right-handed millionaire.
But wasn't that in the day before the lively ball?
Believe me, Howard, with Lindsay around, it's lively, but it's no ball.
Nelson Rocky Rockefeller, you're in the big time now. And now that you're up there, Rocky, now that you're on the top, from your own experience, do you have any words of advice for young people just starting out?
Yes, I do. Kids, remember one thing. Money isn't everything.
You mean to tell me that money isn't everything?
Yes, Howard, money is not everything. I should know. I have them both. I have money, and I also have everything.
Nelson A. Rockefeller, may you win fame and fortune.
WNIX, the White House.
Premier Kosygin, Chairman Mao, Prime Minister Heath, thank you all for coming. Gentlemen, we face a very serious crisis. World War III may very well be right around the corner.
Daddy! Daddy!
Yes, excuse me, gentlemen. Yes, Julie, what is it, dear?
Look! No cavities!
What? No caviar?
No cavities, Premier Kosygin.
Amazing! How did she do it?
Julie, was it that new toothpaste we've been using?
I don't know. It was either that or my new feminine hygiene spray.
Good afternoon. This is Dick Nixon and the Foreign Affairs. Buenos dias, bonjour, shalom, and hello. In foreign, that all means hello. With me on Foreign Affairs tonight is Vice President Agnew and Dr. Henry Kissinger.
Mr. Vice President, do you have any fresh observations on foreign policy?
Yes, I certainly do, but I don't know who I should begin with. The gooks or the hunkies or the japs or the yippies.
Well, in that case, maybe we better move on to Mr. Kissinger.
Well, Dick, I haven't even said anything yet. You always do that to me just when I'm starting to go good. Dick, I heard a rumor the other day. Is it true that you intend to dump me in 72?
Dump you, Spiro? I understand, of course, your fear of being dumped. It's, of course, very close to me. In 1960, I was dumped. In 1962, I got a good dumping in California. And let me say this, Spiro. If you're going to be dumped, California's a beautiful place to be dumped.
Dick, I'm gonna hold my breath until you promise not to dump me.
This is Dick Nixon saying we'll talk about foreign affairs as soon as they get better.
This is Martha again. It's 2 a.m. and time for my Listen to Martha, a unique telephone answering show where Martha calls important government figures at 2 in the morning and they listen and listen and listen. And now, here's Martha.
Mr. Humphrey, do you accept the charges?
I guess so, but who is it at this ungodly hour?
Go ahead, please.
Oh, Mr. Humphrey?
Who is this?
Oh, Herbert Humphrey. It's Listen to Martha time.
Oh, my God. Operator, operator.
Herman, I heard you was back to teaching again, so I called to say that you radic-lib, permissive, wild-eyed, moderate communist educators are entirely responsible for all the riots and snowstorms we've had lately.
Well, that's just ridiculous.
Oh, no, it's not, Hobart. My husband's got a list, and he's attorney general. So you educators better shape up.
Arthur, I'm not even teaching anymore. I'm a senator now.
Well, that's worse. My husband always says the damn Senate never does anything you want them to.
I've got to get some sleep
now.
Oh,
no. Not before you answer Martha's question of the night.
All right, what is the question of the night?
Ready? Here it is. Humbert, when did you stop beating your wife?
I've had enough of this now.
Time's up. Now, what have you got to say for yourself?
Martha, for the first time in my life, I'm speechless. But let me say this.
Sorry, we're out of time, Homer. But one last warning. You better watch what you say, because my husband's having your mouth tapped.
Well, I've never been so insulted in all of my career. I tell you, I...
Ready with your call to Senator Fulbright.
Hello?
Oh, is Senator Fulbright there?
Who's calling him?
It's Listen to Martha time.
I'm terribly sorry, but the Senator's not in right now.
Who's this?
This is the Senator's answering service.
Oh.
Is there anything that you wanted to tell him?
Well, just say that Martha called to say hello and that she's gonna have him crucified again.
Well, I'll be sure to tell him that when he comes in.
I always seem to miss him.
Ready with your call to Maine.
Oh, yes. Senator Muskie? Oh, I'm afraid that's all for tonight, folks. I just heard my husband come in, and we wouldn't want him to catch me on the telephone, would we? Just talking to Mother, sugar. Tomorrow night, my guests will include Senators Hatfield, Javits, and McGovern. So keep those cards and hate-filled letters coming in. Good night.
And now, before we go off the air, a thought for tomorrow by the Reverend Billy Graham. Take it, Billy.
He is our Savior. He is our Redeemer. Get down on your knees and pray to him. Bless him, for he is the Lord.
Billy, I think that sometimes when you talk about me, you go just a little bit too far.
Is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway. But more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and I saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall. And did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing. And now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing. To think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not. To say the thing he truly feels, and not the of one who kneels. The record shows I took those blows. And let me make it perfectly clear, I did it my way.